Think you're ready for the part 107 knowledge test? Well, let's find out. These are the top 5 questions that drone pilots get wrong over and over again. And we're going to break each one down to see why they keep getting missed, so you don't make the same mistake. Plus, we'll answer the big question that pilots don't consider enough. Hi, I'm Greg from Pilot Institute, the online ground school that makes aviation easy. Okay, let's jump right in. While monitoring the Cooperstown CTAF, you hear an aircraft announce that they are midfield left downwind to runway 13. Where would the aircraft be relative to the runway? Now, your choices are west, east, or south. This one's actually tough because it tests two things that drone pilots don't usually think about: runway numbers and airport traffic patterns. When you take the test, you'll have a sectional chart that you can reference for the question. But guess what? You don't even need it. Just grab some scratch paper here. First, figure out which way the runway are facing. Runway numbers are based on magnetic heading, so take the number, in this case 13, add a 0, and you'll get the approximate direction in degrees that the runway is facing. Runway 13 points to 130 degrees, 130 degrees, that's roughly southeast. Now sketch a simple runway that is pointing southeast, top left to bottom right. And if you check your work with the sectional chart, you can see that the runway orientation matches. Next, you'll need to know how a traffic pattern works. The pilot reported that they're on the left downwind, so that means that they're flying a left-hand pattern with all turns to the left. Sounds pretty obvious. There are 5 different legs in a traffic pattern: departure, crosswind, downwind, base, and final. Now imagine the pilot took off from runway 13, heading to the southeast. Then they turn left onto the crosswind, and another left onto the downwind, flying parallel to the runway but in the opposite direction. Midfield here just means that the airplane is about halfway along the downwind, right about here. And that places the airplane generally about east of the airport, making B the most correct answer. All right, let's take a look at another question. When a control tower located on an airport within Class B airspace ceases operation for the day, what happens to the airspace designation? It's easy to see here why this one gets missed. Airspace regulation can be confusing. Now let's start with what defines Class Delta, Class D. It's controlled airspace that surrounds an airport with an operational control tower. Usually you find Class D airspace at smaller airports that are busy enough to need ATC, but not so busy that they need Class C or Class B airspace. But many of these Class D towers don't operate 24/7. At night, for example, when traffic slows down, the tower closes. When that happens, pilots switch to self-announcing their arrival and departures on the CTAF frequency. But what about the airspace? Well, here are your options. A, the airspace reverts to Class E or a combination of Class E and Class G airspace. B, the airspace stays Class D as long as there is a weather observer or automated weather system. C, the airspace normally won't change. Well, here's the key. Class D requires an operational tower. No operating tower, no Class D. So that eliminates B and C as an answer. Instead, the airspace reverts to a lower classification, Class E to the surface, or even sometimes Class G up to Class E floor, depending on the airport. Now you can find the details in the chart supplement, so in this case, answer A is going to be the correct answer. Here's a weather question that catches people off guard because, well, it's pretty much a rare topic. You're flying near mountains and there are lenticular clouds. What kind of weather should you expect? And here are the choices: A, snow showers; B, smooth air; C, high wind and turbulence. Now this one comes down to knowing how and where clouds are going to form. And lenticular clouds are one type that's hard to forget. They're even sometimes mistaken for UFO. And here's what they look like. Wait, no, no, no. This is what they look like. All right, more seriously, this is actual footage right here. Lenticular clouds can form when strong, stable winds of about 40 knots blow over the mountain ridge, and as the air flows uphill, it's going to cool. And eventually, it hits the dew point. That's the temperature where the air can't hold any more moisture as vapor, and at that point, the water condenses into a lens-shaped cloud right at the crest. But these clouds don't produce precipitation, so you can cross off A, snow showers. And as the air flows back down the other side, called the lee side, it warms up again. Now the moisture evaporates, making the cloud seem fixed in place. So smooth air might seem like actually a good guess, because the cloud looks very smooth, but the air downwind of them is actually anything but smooth. And as the air flows up and down over the ridge, it creates standing waves in the atmosphere, kind of like the ripples in a stream. These are areas of intense rolling turbulence. Now, sometimes they form clouds also, but often they're just invisible. Now, that makes them extremely hazardous to both manned and unmanned aircraft. So when you're near mountains and you see lenticular clouds, expect some high winds and some turbulence. Okay, here's a question that you really have to look at closely. While inspecting the obstacle located 3 miles northwest of Coeur d'Alene Boeington Airport, what is the highest altitude above ground level that you can fly? And the choices are A, 2,429 feet AGL, the height of the obstacle, B, 400 feet above the ground, and C, 400 feet above the top of the obstacle if you stay within 400 feet horizontally. The test supplement gives you a sectional chart excerpt with this question. And here's the obstacle between the power line and the railroad track. Now let's start by eliminating the obvious one here. 2,429 feet is the obstacle elevation above sea level, MSL, not above the ground, AGL. AGL heights are always in parentheses on the sectional charts. Second, the height of a structure is never your legal limit as a drone pilot. And here's one more clue. The obstacle is marked here with a small obstruction symbol, which means that it's under 1,000 feet AGL. If it were really 2,400 feet tall, one of the tallest structures on Earth, you'd actually see the largest symbol instead. Okay, now we're down to two options. Answer C seems like it could be right. Part 10751 does allow you to fly up to 400 feet above a structure as long as you stay within 400-foot radius. But does it apply here? Well, take another look at the sectional chart from the test supplement. Coeur d'Alene Airport is surrounded by a dash magenta line. Now that tells us that it's surface class E airspace in controlled airspace designated for an airport, also known as E2. So now we have to bring in another regulation. Under Part 10741, you cannot operate in E2 airspace without having prior authorization from ATC. Now, depending on the airport here, that authorization might come through LANTS or through the FAA drone zone. Either way, you have to follow the terms of that authorization. And here's what the FAA says, straight from their own website. LANTS provides drone pilots with access to controlled airspace at or below 400 feet. And that's pretty clear. Even if you request to fly above the grid number via LANTS, you're still going to be capped at 400 feet AGL. Now, in fact, when you receive your LANTS authorization, it specifically says altitude limits are absolute values above ground level, which shall not be added to the height of any structures. And what about the drone zone? Well, here's what the FAA says. You can apply for authorization above the approved altitudes on the UAS facility maps, but at or below 400 feet AGL. So with a standard authorization, you're not allowed to fly above 400 feet AGL, above ground level, in class E2 airspace. This means the exemption for obstacles in 10751 does not apply to this situation, which leaves us basically with answer B, 400 feet above the ground. And yes, in theory, this is the most correct answer, but the FAA should really have said either maximum of 400 feet above the ground or the maximum altitude permissible on the LANTS grid because, well, the LANTS grid here in this area might or might not go up to 400 feet. Yeah, that's right, this one is confusing. This next question covers a topic that 76% of test takers got wrong last year, which best describes a declaration of compliance. And if you look at the answers, you can see why. They all sound pretty convincing. So let's work through this one. If you're flying under Part 107, you know that your drone has to broadcast remote ID, unless you're operating at a FRIA, an FAA recognized identification area. But to be legal, a remote ID system has to meet FAA requirements. And that's where the Declaration of Compliance, or DOC, comes in. A remote ID DOC is a document that manufacturers are going to submit to the FAA, certifying that a specific drone or a module meets the standards. And if you're flying over people, you may also need to have a second DOC, a Declaration of Compliance for Operations Over People, or an OOP DOC. I know, FAA loves those acronyms. Now that shows that the drone meets the requirements to do that safely. So the correct answer here is C, a document submitted to the FAA stating that a drone complies with either remote ID requirements or OOP requirements, operations over people. Now let's look at the distractors here. Well, this one is actually describing an airworthiness certificate. It's an FAA document that certifies an aircraft meets safety and design standards. Now, they're usually issued for manned aircraft, but for some drones, like those that are operated by drone delivery companies, they require one as well. And while it might sound similar to an operation over people declaration of compliance, it's not really the same thing. Answer B here is referring to the means of compliance, or MOC. Now that's a document that outlines the test methods that are used in order to prove compliance. That's the step before getting a declaration of compliance. So not the same document that actually shows the compliance. Okay, this brings us to the biggest question that new pilots need to ask themselves. Do you actually need a course in order to pass the Part 107 test? Well, the choice is actually yours, but about 1 in 3 people who self-study end up failing on the first try. I'm gonna say that again. 1 in 3 people who self-study end up failing on the first try. So if you want to be ready for anything that the FAA is gonna throw at you, then check out our Part 107 Made Easy course. You get 15 hours of video content, unlimited practice exams, and over 300 quiz questions. So you can walk into the test confident and prepared. And this is why we've trained over 100,000 pilots to pass this exam with an average score of 92 on the final exam. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.